Good morning, my young friends. Thank you, Santosh, and thanks, KP, for the introduction. How many of you are postgraduate students here? Can I see a show of hand? All of you. All of, that's good. And how many of you in final year? Okay, so it's a good mix. You know, over the years, goals of cataract surgery have changed. In the past, it was a rehabilitative cataract surgery, but we have evolved. And today, we focus on refractive cataract surgery. Most of our patients actually want to see extremely well at all distances of their performance without depending on glasses. And most of the time, we as cataract surgeons are able to meet their requirements. And majority of the patients and the surgeons are happy. If you see, you know, the happiness spills over, you know, into the social media. And you have both the parties extremely thrilled, and you know they're happy and they're smiling. So most of the patients actually do well in all respects after cataract surgery. From time to time, we do have patients who are a bit disgruntled, you know, who are not satisfied. There are various reasons for that, and what I'm going to talk to you about is those patients who are unhappy because of a refractive surprise. So in cataract surgery, we always target emmetropia. It is not always emmetropia. In certain categories of patients, we also target a little bit of myopia. For example, when you think about monovision, when you think about certain advanced technology lenses like EDOF lenses, et cetera, et cetera. So there are four aspects to it. How do we go about it? Perform a very safe surgery. Now, if you have used a advanced technology lens, a lifestyle intraocular lens, and post-operative day one, the cornea is hazy, there's a central SK. It doesn't make any difference to the patient. Or if the surgeon has chewed up the iris tissue or created, posted a capsular rent or a zonular dialysis, where you know these problems take precedence over emmetropic refraction because you want the patient not to lose eyesight. So you have to have a very good surgical skills, first thing. You also need to take care of the pre-existing corneal astigmatism. You may do a perfect surgery, but post-operatively, patients will still require glasses for the distance vision because patient has got corneal astigmatism. So it has to be taken care of. And today we do toric intraocular lenses for that. Earlier on, there are many various other options. And finally, if a patient wants to see well at all distances of his or her work performance without using glasses, you have to use a premium intraocular lens. A bifocal lens, or a trifocal lens, or extended depth of focus lens, or accommodative lens. Now, all these things today are beyond the syllabus today. I mean, we are not going to talk about it. And all these will come to naught if you have not calculated the intraocular lens power properly. If you have calculated a long lens power, and everything has gone off well, you have done a fantastic surgery, you have taken care of the astigmatism, you have implanted a very high quality, very good optical quality, lifestyle intraocular lens, and it is not going to make any difference. So before I start my presentation, I would like to pay a tribute to some of the teachers who have taught us about IL power calculations. Can anybody tell me who is this gentleman? Warren Hill. Have you heard about him? Who is he? Ken Hoffer? Ken J. Hoffer? Who is this gentleman? Jack Holliday, who is this? Heigis, Wolfgang Heigis from Germany. Who is this? Graham Barrett from Australia. Thomas Olsen. And finally, this is a new kid on the block. He's from Israel. He's done a lot of training. So I have done a lot of courses on intraocular lens power calculations with these giants, and I have learned a great deal from them. They are big names. They have taught us how to do proper IL calculation, and always my talk on this topic is always a tribute to them. So I have nothing financial in what I'm going to talk to you about today. How many of you do your own IL calculation, biometry? Show of hands. I think it will be about maybe 30 to 40% of you present here. Okay. So today I'm not going to talk to you about the hardware involved in IL power calculation, that is how to do a keratometry, how to do A-scan biometry, how to do an optical biometry, because you know this requires hands-on experience with the devices, which you can, you know, you can ask a technician from the company to come to your department and give you hands-on experience. You know, discuss all the everything about the particular instrument. I tried to do that in a couple of years ago in one similar talk, and I don't think I was able to do much justice to it. But anyway, the talk is there on the YouTube, so you could see my YouTube video. 29 November 1949 is a very important day in ophthalmology. Anybody knows why? Anybody knows who this gentleman is? Harold Ridley? Yeah. So he was the first cataract surgeon who implanted an intraocular lens. He started off intraocular lenses in human beings. So the initial pioneers, Harold Ridley, Richard Binghorst, and then Peter Choice, Jan Worst, you know, they formed an intraocular implant club. And I was recently, it's a very exclusive club, and I was recently inducted into that particular club. Now, when Ridley initially did his cataract surgery, his experiences were not very favorable. You know, he published his results in BJO 1952. The first audit cycle had two patients, and both the patients had a very highly myopic outcome. One patient landed up with minus 21 diopter, other patient had minus 15 diopter. So what had gone wrong was he had collaborated with a company called Rayner. They had used a plastic, polymethyl methacrylate, which had exactly the same dimensions of the crystalline lens, and as a result of which, both these patients were overcorrected. So definitely, you know, it was not a very desirable postoperative outcome, refractive outcome. So they tweaked, the company tweaked the lens dimensions, and then second audit cycle had 25 patients. Here, the median post-op refractive error again was minus 2.25 diopter. And the range was quite wide, you know, varying from minus 10.5 to plus 4.5 diopter spherical equivalent. Now, this will not pass muster today. I mean, if you do cataract surgery and a patient lands up in a situation like that, you know, we are going to deal with a very difficult patient. So where do we stand today? That is something that we need to know. I would refer to data which I obtained from Warren Hill's website, hill.com. So many surgeons all over the world share their postoperative refractive outcome in his database. So this is actually 2.6 lakh eyes of cataract surgeons who used the database provided by Warren Hill. And from these 2.6 lakh eyes, there are three types of surgeons. Group A were those surgeons who had 92% of their postoperative patients landing within plus minus 0.5 diopter, very good result. And then there was another group of surgeon where the incidence which clustered was 84%. I mean, these surgeons in this group had 84% of their post-op patients within the cluster of plus minus 0.5, and then rest of the surgeons, which was this level of accuracy was seen only in 78% of the patients. So only 1% of the surgeons belong to this elite group. And then, you know, the next group is only 6% of the surgeons, and majority of the surgeons belong to this group. So as you see, the refractive outcomes are not yet what it should be. For surgeons in all these three grades, it is always possible to upscale from grade C to grade B to grade A. Grade A surgeon, elite surgeon, can always improve his results from 92%, plus minus 0.5 diopter, to maybe 95% or even 100%. So we have some way to go. So this brings me to the topic of ILPAR calculation. So you said about 30 to 40% of you have done ILPAR calculation. See, for most of us, as a postgraduate student or as a fellow, ILPAR calculation is just a one-off incident. It's just like a hit and run. You do the calculation and somebody does the surgery. Maybe you yourself end up doing the surgery. But what happens in the postoperative period and how to, you know, learn from your experience, postoperative outcome, most of the time we really ignore it. That's very important. And what I would like to convey to you that ILPAR calculation is not a one-off incident. It is a process. It is an exercise which spans the preoperative period, intraoperative period, and the postoperative period. Now, preoperatively is important because before I do the scan, I would like to know what exactly was the patient's cause of loss of vision. And there are certain factors which make the calculations difficult. Let me give an example. A patient with high myopia. Let's say a patient of 30 millimeter axial length. Can anybody tell me what do you expect for that patient? Posterior staphyloma? Isn't it? So patients with axial length of 30 millimeters usually have a 33% incidence, and as the axial length increases, it goes up. So these patients may not be able to fix it properly. You may have some patients who have a posterior subcapsular cataract where the optical biometry still gives a result, but it still may not be accurate because the patient doesn't have proper fixation. So beforehand, I would like to know whether my patient belongs to this category or not. So pre-op evaluation from this perspective is very, very important. Last couple of years, we have come to know that ocular surface plays a very important role in biometry. So any patient coming to our clinic for a cataract surgery, we have an ocular surface workup routinely, 100% of the patients. And then if we find that they have an ocular surface disease, we would not perform a biometry for that patient. We would optimize the ocular surface, put some lubricating drops and call the patient back. And then I'll do two or three readings which will be reproducible. They'll give the same results. Then I accept that, yes, the ocular surface has been optimized and now the values which I'm getting are relatively reliable. Another thing that we most of the time do is when a patient comes to you, all the workup is done and somebody has advised cataract surgery, you do the keratometry, you do the scan biometry pack and topography. That is something which should not be done. Because all these tests, all these delicate tests have to be done on the virgin cornea. A cornea which has not been insulted with dilating drops, with preservatives, a cornea which has not been kept open for a long period of time, a cornea where an applanation procedure like the Goldman applanation tonometry or pachymetry or gonioscopy. So make sure that, these tests, biometry should be done for these patients at a later stage. Call the patient back on another day. Patient counseling is again very, very important. See, most of the time we target plano refraction, make the patient emmetropic, but there are certain patients who would like to be myopic. So you cannot just often decide on your own that, okay, I'll put an intraocular lens power in such a manner that the patient becomes plano for distance. No. So you need to know the patient's lifestyle. You need to know which distance the patient is most of the time working. And you may have to tweak the intraocular lens power accordingly. There are certain intraocular lenses, advanced technology lenses, for example, the EDOF lenses, where we look for a myopic outcome, slightly mini monovision, slightly myopic outcome on the non-dominant eye. So patient counseling is very important. Biometric measurement and calculation of intraocular lens power is never done with only one instrument. Minimum of two instruments, I end up using three or four devices to get my biometric measurements. And then I also use at least three or four formulas to find out what exactly is the intraocular lens power that is required for the patient. And after taking everything into consideration, we select the intraocular lens power. So preoperative workup is very, very important. So next time, before you do a biometry, please ensure that you have gone through the entire list and then do the biometry. Intraoperative also plays an important role because we'll be talking about ELP, effective lens position. Anybody knows what is ELP? Show of hands. So basically, when we do cataract surgery, the lens is kept in the capsular bag, isn't it? Where the crystalline lens was there, we have removed the lens matter, made a small opening, entered a capsular opening, and put the lens in the bag. So that is, and when the formulas calculate the intraocular lens power, they do in two stages. In first stage, using all the biometric data, they calculate where exactly the lens is going to sit, effective lens position. And then again, they recalculate, try to find out what exactly should be the power of the lens that will give the desired refractive outcome to the patient. So we need to be very careful about where we keep the intraocular lens. So please make sure that your axis that we is about 5 to 5.5 millimeters. It has a 0.5 to 0.75 millimeter overlap on the capsular margin, on the intraocular lens optic. And that way we can have some control over the effective lens position. See, we put the lens in the capsular bag. It stays in the posterior, in the bag. But down the line, capsular contracture occurs, mother nature takes over, and we really do not know where the lens is going to sit. But this is the most we could do in a more predictable manner, keep the lens within the capsular bag and have a axis which is about 5 to 5.5 millimeters in size. There are a few new technology that have come in, intraoperative aberrometry and guidance system for the toric intraocular lenses. Again, that is beyond the syllabus. I'm not going to talk more about it in this particular meeting, in this particular talk. But what I would like to emphasize here is this point. If you are not able to keep the lens in the capsular bag and you go for an alternative position, the intraocular lens power has to be adjusted. Now, this is what is put up in Warren Hill's website, and I have the same thing on my OT wall. So if a lens cannot be kept in the capsular bag because of a PC dent or whatever, you know, unstable capsular bag situation, I keep the lens in the sulcus, the intraocular lens power, it comes down. Rule of the thumb is 5%, but it depends upon what exactly was the original power of the lens. So it varies from no change. For example, patient who requires a plus 9 diopter onwards, downwards, you don't have to change the power. But if you are keeping a bag lens in the sulcus, and if the lens power is 30 diopters, you have to keep a 28.5 diopter lens in the sulcus. So this is something that has to be definitely kept in our mind. Postoperative period is again very important. It is important because this is the moment of truth. You have done all the good work, and on the first day, you get to know what is the patient seeing. Is the patient emmetropic, or does the patient have a refractive error? What is the spherical equivalent? So this is very, very important. And depending upon that, you take your further course correction. Supposing if you're on the target, fine. You're on the right track. But supposing if you have a refractive surprise, you're veered away from the target refraction, then you have to do a lot of exercises, which I'll be talking to you about. So far, so good. I know I'm audible. There's a mic here. But am I making any sense? Yes or no? See, this is a very important topic. This is a very dry topic. But, always, and most of the important things, if you want to reduce your weight, you have to go on some kind of a diet, which you don't want, but you have to do it. So this is something like that, but it is very, very important. Now, second thing that I'll be talking to you about is the intraocular lens power formulas. Now, this is the generational classification of the formulas. See, today experts do not prefer this classification because this is a mishmash. This is a hodgepodge. It is a very heterogeneous group. For example, there are different types of formulas. You have vergence formulas. You have regression analysis formulas. You have ray tracing formulas. You have artificial intelligence-based formulas. So you just kind of put different types of formulas in terms of generation in a chronological order. So I think this is something that is becoming obsolete, though examiners may ask you from time to time the different generation classification of the formulas. But I think this is going to be more accepted. We classify the intraocular lens power formula depending upon the method of calculating the power and the data that has been used. So these are the five techniques. Now, historical or refraction-based is something which is again gone. When I was a PG, my teachers, so one teacher will say that, okay, Dr. Arup, all my patients will get 18 diopters. Another professor will say, all my patients will get 21 diopters. And same professor, if he had a problem at home with his wife, it will be very erratic to predict what power he's going to use. So this is obsolete. This is totally unscientific. When you can measure the eye, we can use so many scientific formulas to go about it. So that is gone. Regression formulas, SRK formula came, SRK 1, SRK 2 came. Now the beauty of all these IL formulas is if you're dealing with an eye that is within the normal range in terms of corneal stiffness or flatness or the axial length, anterior chamber depth, lens thickness, etc., all the formulas do the same, give you the same result. But you never know. See, just by looking at a patient's eye, just because the anterior chamber is shallow, there is no guarantee that the posterior segment will not be longer than what you expect. So it is important that you do not use these formulas. SRK2 also should be obsolete. There are a lot of social media groups, and I love to teach. I used to participate in group discussions and fights and all that academically. So one senior professor told me that, Dr. Arup, SRKT is the best. Please do not mislead the people, because using your experience, using your intuition, you can definitely give very good result to the patient. But you guys, when you pass out after your MS, and then you finish your fellowship and start your practice, you are practicing with established senior surgeons. You cannot afford to make mistakes. You cannot afford to say that, it is my intuition. I feel I'm going to do well with this particular power. No, so SRK2 is obsolete. We never use it. Some of these, ultrasonic biometers still carry, all these biometers have calculators, so they still carry SRK2, but for God's sake, forget the SRK2 formulas. Vergence formulas, I think, is the most popular one. 2017, we celebrated the golden jubilee of Fyodorov formula. That was the first theoretical formula based on Gaussian optics. Anybody has heard about Fyodorov? Sputnik? Fyodorov came up with the Sputnik lens. Anybody has heard about the Sputnik lens? You guys are not reading history. Eh? Anyway, so Fyodorov was a Russian ophthalmologist. He was an innovator. He was a great man. He was actually, he was an amputee. He's a war veteran. So he had a huge operation theater. I have seen this operation theater. It used to work on an assembly line because he couldn't move. So he'll sit in one place and the patients will move in a circle, in a tabletop. So he was assassinated because I'm told that he had presidential aspirations. He wanted to become the president of USSR those days. Anyway, so he started off the first formula, the Fyodorov's Vergence formula, and that spawned more than 30 or 40 theoretical formulas. The Vergence formulas today, for sake of simplicity, we classify into two variable formulas, Holliday 1, SRKT, Hoffer Q. Three variable formulas, Huygens, Leder super formula. Five variable formulas are Barrett Universal 2. Seven variable formulas, Holliday 2. Now, the question is, which formula should we be using? Now, I'm asking you, the madam, you're sitting on the front. Okay, so how old is your cell phone? How many years? We don't use a cell phone which is 10 years, 15 years old, isn't it? Nobody drives a car which is 15, 20 years old. Recently, two brilliant young pilots died in an air crash in Bangalore. They are flying aircrafts which are older than them, more than 30 years old. So we feel that most of these formulas that I have spoken so far were published about 20 to 30 years ago. So they are old. They don't belong to this millennium. There are only three formulas which belong to this millennium. Those formulas are Barrett Universal 2 and two more formulas I'm going to talk to you about. So what are these two variable formulas? What are the variables these formulas use? Can anybody volunteer? Keratometry and the axial length. So that's the only thing. Three variable formula also takes into account the anterior chamber depth. Five variable formula also takes into account the white to white diameter and the lens thickness. Seven variable formulas also factor in the patient's age and the preoperative vision. All right, so these are the various things. Now the fourth category is artificial intelligence, and artificial intelligence is becoming very, very important in all spheres of our activity. Also in ophthalmology, in posterior segment, it has found a very important application, as well as in glaucoma diagnosis. So HEAL RBA formula, a little bit in a future slide, is a very popular formula. And then another thing is the ray tracing formula, Oculix and Phacoptics. Unfortunately, these formulas have to be purchased. You have to, otherwise you don't have access to these formulas. So basically, there are only three formulas which belong to this millennium, that is Barrett Universal 2, Olsen C, and HEAL RBF. Okay. So this is something which we used to talk about maybe 4 or 5 years earlier. We don't really have to do it because now we have much better formulas which take the measurements, which do the calculations for all kinds of eyes. So a little bit about one of the most popular and most important formula in the world today, Barrett Universal 2 formula. The best part of this formula is it is free. Now, this formula also comes loaded with certain optical biometers, like Lens Star sold by Hagstreet or Zeiss IL-Master 700. But even if you don't have these optical biometers, you can still go to the respective websites and plug in your data, all the biometric calculations, all the variables, and you can still use the formulas and come out with great results. So Barrett formula, actually, it is a suite of formulas. It does everything, whatever IL power requirements, all kinds of eyes, secondary ILs, piggyback intraocular lenses, IOL exchange, IL power calculation after in complex situations like after keratorefractive surgery, in high myopia, and after radial keratotomy, and all these things. And I'm not going to the details. I just want you to be aware of Barrett Universal 2 formula that exists. And this is one of the best formulas. There is no second opinion about it. It is accurate for all eyes, regardless of the axial length. Only thing is, you have to use the proper refractive index, proper index, the mu value. So this is the value that has to be used. You can use the A constant that comes with the IL on the IL box, or you can get download the ULIB A constant from the one Hygiese's website. So there are mandatory variables. Are if you can measure the axial length, K reading, and optical anterior chamber depth, refraction, fine. You don't really have to measure the lens thickness and white to white. If you measure it, fine. Then maybe the formula will give you more precise, more accurate values. Otherwise, also the formula will give you results. You don't have to modify the axial length. Now, you know, measurement of the axial length can be done by two techniques at our level, as a resident level. Can anybody volunteer? How do we do it? So I mentioned earlier that I'm not going to talk about the hardware. I'm not going to talk to you about the ultrasonic biometers or optical biometers, because it is not possible for me to just talk and teach. Best is to, you know, handle this equipment and go to the stalls or ask those company people to come to your department and teach you. So basically two ways of measuring the axial length. One is using sound, other one is using light. Ultrasonic biometer, optical biometer. Ultrasonic biometer, the sound gets, it gives length up to the internal limiting membrane. The optical biometer gives length up to the RPE, Brooks membrane complex. All right, so there is some difference. And whatever it is, you know, I mean, we always assume a global index for both these formulas, like velocity of sound. Sound passes through the cornea, it passes through the aqueous, crystalline lens, and which may be in different states of, in different degrees of advanced cataract. It goes to the vitreous. Same thing about light. So we really do not compartmentalize the eye and, you know, measure individual segment, though this is becoming useful. This is being done for optical biometry now. You know, and each component is measured separately and added up, but still we have a global index. And that also brings in some, you know, some inaccuracy in the axial length measurements, even if you're using an optical biometer. So there are ways of correcting it. I'll not go into it. So Hill, Barrett Universal 2, all the advantages, most of the advantages I mentioned. Another formula which has been, which has taken us, by its, which has really been accepted by most of us is Hill RBA formula. And like many good things in life, you know, it also comes free. You can get it at the AACRS website. This is basically dependent upon pattern recognition and, artificial intelligence based. And the beauty of this particular formula is it tells you when it is unable to calculate the results. So it will flag you that, okay, this software doesn't tell you more about IL power, if it is a very short eye or it's a very long eye. So this is again free. You can go to the aacrs.org website and get it, okay? Now, this is about the formulas and the values that you require. Now, it is important for us that the values that you get, measure the cornea, measure the axial length, they have to be accurate. See, for example, today morning when I was standing, you know, in front on the weighing machine, I saw a number, which I have never seen for the last 10 years. So I was really thrilled, you know, I was so happy that 50% of the time, it is showing an abnormal number, all right? It was, so you have to ensure that whichever machine that you're using, it has to be properly calibrated, and the results that you get, they have to be properly assessed. You have to really validate the outcomes, all right? So make sure that, you know, the formulas will give you good results only if your values are good, if the data variables that you've calculated are good quality data. So today, the central corneal power is calculated by reflective keratometry, which comes in most of the optical biometry machines. Swept source OCT is becoming very popular. This particular device also measures the, you know, posterior corneal astigmatism. It gives you the total corneal measurement. Axial measurement, of course, with optical biometry, we have reached a very sophisticated level. So we are able to measure the central corneal power, axial measurement very well. And now our level of accuracy has become so good. Only thing is that the IL manufacturers are not able to keep company with our progress. See, if you see the lenses, they come in steps of 0.5. Am I right? 20, 20.5, 21, all right. Now, if your formula tells you that you have to use a lens which is 21.1 diopter, what do? So the lens manufacturers, you know, they have some kind of a, you know, so they don't put the exact power of the lens. So they also have to come up with lenses which have steps of 0.25, you know, so that we can really get what we want from the patient. A step of 0.5 is just inadequate in today's world where our investigations and formulas have become so sophisticated. I mentioned already about the effective lens position. I think that is one aspect which still has to be worked out. Validation guidelines, you know, you get the values. Now what happens is, you know, you do the surgery and your outcome is evaluated by the patients in terms of the surgical outcomes. Let your patients, your peers, they are not bothered about which higher, how expensive machine you're using, what kind of microscope you're using, what kind of posh setup. No, they want to get the target refraction. So that is the way you are judged. Now, if you delegate responsibilities to some optometrists or some junior postgraduates with the proper orientation, and they come up with some report and you accept it at face value, and without really correlating, validating the values, the numbers that you have come across, you are going to be off the target. So post-operatively, you will have a situation where patient has have a refractive surprise, and then you tell them all sorts of excuses, lame excuses as to why it happened and why it is good for him and all that. So that could have been saved if you just deleted that abnormal result, remeasured the eye, till all these validation criteria were satisfied. So these guidelines actually are put up on my wall. I'm not going into the details. So each reading has to be validated on multiple factors. All right. Another thing that is important is, anybody knows what is an A constant of a lens? Anybody has done IOL surgery here? Anybody has implanted a PC lens? Can I see your hand? Okay, so I think I'm on? Over. 5 minutes, okay. I think I should be done by then. So it is important for us to be familiar with the lens constant, A constant of the particular intraocular lens, okay? So most of the time, you know, when you have a reputed manufacturer, a multinational company, the A constant will be written on the lens box. So you have to find out whether it talks about the optical A constant or it talks about the ultrasonic A constant, because these two are different entities. If you're doing an ultrasonic biometry, you should use the ultrasonic A constant. If you're doing an optical biometry, you should be using the optical A constant, all right. But now what happens if there is a new company selling new lenses and now they give me a lens today, then I will be very loath to use a new lens because I'm not sure what the A constant is. A constant really fine-tunes me to get a proper result. So I'll ask him what kind of biometry was done when you did the A constant. Was it an optical or ultrasonic? I'll also ask which formula did he use. If they say I've used a SRK2, then I will not even touch the lens. Then I'll also ask the company, the agent representative, that, you know, who was the surgeon who did it. If I know it was a good surgeon like Rashmin, I'll say fine, I accept the value. But somebody whom I don't even know, and only 10 cases have been done. Of course, you know, I'm not going to rely on the A constant which has come with this machine. In that case, I'll have to optimize my A constant. So what I would do is I'll accept the company's A constant value, and then I'll see my refractive results and change my A constant by a factor of 0.1 every 10 cases, not suddenly 0.5. Go slow. Say, but roughly about 20 to 30 cases, you should be able to optimize your A constant. A constant also can be optimized individually, as I mentioned here. You can even get it optimized by sharing your results with various databases. Warren Hill's website, you could do it. You could do it ULIB, which is Wolfgang Haggis's website. And you could also do, the companies also will do it for you. Another important thing that I did not know three, four years back was the length of the examination lane. Like when I was a postgraduate student in medical college, they have big halls. So the distance, it was actually, you know, 6 meters. So the chart was, I mean, the patient was seated 6 meters. Now in a bigger cities where space is a constraint, you know, we have examination length, which is 3 meters or 4 meters. And you get a particular refractive error, you calculate the spherical equivalent. You know, that is not right. So you have to modify the spherical equivalent by this formula and then use this for calculation of A constant. So friends, I think I have spoken a lot of things which are basically current concepts, but very easy to understand. Whole world is using these lenses, these particular concepts, and getting fantastic results. We still have some way to go from group A, B to groups A, group C to group B, and then through group A. So basically, I mean, we have to keep on improving by using validated measurements, work with properly optimized lens constants. You have to adapt to new technologies as they present, instead of telling that, you know, I mean, with my experience, anything, I'm very happy with older instruments. No, new technology comes in. You have to get the new technology and apply it in your practice, and strive to use all available resources to the best advantage. Thank you so much. It is just the stepping stone for you. I mean, I have just given a little bit of push for you to know where we stand today. When you go back, you have to do the homework. I'm available on my email, arupai@gmail.com. If any queries, if any doubts you have, please feel free to get in touch with me. Thank you so much. Thank you, Rashmin. Thank you, Santosh.